This is where I want to start this week, Scott. You're in the midst of a pretty substantial vacation, as far as I'm concerned. When I was working jobby jobs, the amount of time that you've taken off is pretty significant. Yeah. What would you consider this a significant vacation that you're on?
Yeah, I don't have to go back until the 17th.
Okay, and today is the 7th. You know, for folks, just so folks can do the math.
And okay. I've already been off for a week.
I need you to speak to the people real quick. Why is it important to take your vacation time? Why is it important to take the time away from the job and really make sure, because, and I've been especially guilty of this, the idea that, oh, well, I need to put all I can into X, Y, and Z, and all the vacation time will be there. I'll take vacation when I have time. So why do you prioritize not only taking vacation, but you'll take 2 weeks off? Why is that important? Speak to the people who got jobs.
From about October all the way through the holidays up to the end of February, I was going very hard.
Mm-hmm.
Taking big swings at a lot of different things, and successfully, mind you. But I was starting to, I don't know. I was moody, you know, so I would kind of get snippy or bark at people a little bit. I was starting to make stupid mistakes.
Mm-hmm.
Little overlooked small details that made big differences. I was starting to drop the ball on those things.
Yeah.
Lack of concentration. All I wanted was sleep. All that. And even here we are a week in, and I've spent the entire time fixing a sagging floor in my house, and I feel like the yoke has been removed.
Mm.
I feel like I'm on a hall pass. I'm out in the field running barefoot, man.
Yeah, you feel
I'm free. I'm riding my bike past the Catholic school where all my buddies went, and they had to go to school, back to school a week before I did. I feel like I'm riding by everybody and just waving. I'm on my bike going, hey,
mm-hmm.
I'm going to go get some ice cream.
So back to the question, why is it important to take time off of work?
To feel this way. I just said, to feel this way. You have to recharge, and you have to get some distance from it, because if you have your head, look at you right now. If you have your head down.
You're turning it around on me.
If you have your head down.
Come on, go ahead.
If you have your head down this long.
Okay.
It's going to start affecting the way that you interact with other people.
Yep.
If you don't have a chance to look at something else, meaning if you can't go and read a book, if you can't go and listen to some other music, something else that you like, if you can't do that, oh my God, that's just going to suck. Your life is just going to suck.
Well, all of that, thank you, Scott. All of that to say, you know, I'm very inspired by your taking vacation time. You've never been shy about that. There's a lot going on in the world right now, a lot going on in our individual lives. So take the time you need, if you need some time, because just my trying to keep up with everything and not, I shouldn't say try to keep up with everything, with my being aware of everything. We're talking about, still talking about Ukraine. There's all sorts of stuff happening in other parts of the world. You know, of course, we have our regular everyday challenges here in the United States, talking about folks talk about gas prices going up. You know, that's something that I have a lot of privilege in, because I don't have to get in my car and drive anywhere every day. But I'm thinking about that single mother who has to take the baby to daycare and then go to work all across town and do X, Y, and Z. And gas is looking the way it does. You know, here in the Twin Cities, is about $4.
Yeah.
I've paid higher than that before, but in, you know, for us, that's very high. So I would hate to see what it looks like over in Southern California and places like that. So anyway, all of that to say, it's a lot going on, y'all. I hope that you will prioritize your health and your recharging. So if that means take some time off work, if that means log off Twitter, cut off CNN or wherever you get your news, please do that. Prayers to Ukraine and to the many other countries facing violence. I'm thinking about Yemen. I'm thinking about Ethiopia, Myanmar, Syria. It's interesting, Scott, how those places, and it's easy for folks to sort of dilute this to oppression Olympics or whatever, but it's interesting how we have been bombarded, and rightfully so, nonstop with news from Ukraine. When there are very similar things happening in other parts of the world, the people just happen to be a little browner, you know, or a little blacker. But those, there are people in those communities being turned into refugees as well, based on civil war and all sorts of other problems. So I just, you know, I'm all of these things circle in my head. I feel like personally, I'm feeling the collective stress of it all. And we need to make sure that we're taking a breather every opportunity we can. With that being said, though, we have a job to do here on Trilloquy, so. But I'm gonna try to keep things positive this week. In that spirit, I wanted to offer a downbeat. We're here in Women's History Month and celebrate a woman named Kira Rudick. Have you heard that name yet, Kira Rudick?
I don't think so.
Yeah, I was doing some research and looking at ways to honor the many women in Ukraine doing many different things. And Kira Rudick's name came up. Kira has been very outspoken about a woman's role in the fight for freedom in Ukraine, the fight against Russia. Mm-hmm. She has inspired many other women to pick up arms and do what has to be done. And she offered this message in light of International Women's Day, which I understand is today as we're taping this. So let's hear what Kira Rudick had to say.
Hey, so it's already past midnight here in Kyiv, and it's officially International Women's Day. Usually on this day, kids are giving their mommies flowers and cards to say how special they are. This year, our kids have been robbed of this opportunity. They are either at refugee camps or very far away from us, to keep them safe. This year, Ukrainian women will receive flowers, but these are not only flowers that we will be carrying, because we are also carrying guns to protect our country along with our men from Putin, crazy dictator, and from the war that Russia is bringing in. I want to congratulate all Ukrainian women who are standing up and fighting. You are incredible. Because of you, we will win.
Kira Rudick, I mean, shout out to her. What can I say? There are so many people who would never, ever openly speak out in the way that she is, much less actually pick up arms and protect one's home, protect one's nation. You come from a military family, a military community. I understand as well as you do the masculine framing around military or around service to country, but we're seeing something very different here. I wonder how hearing from Kira Rudick impacts your perspective or and the experiences you have surrounding that idea of picking up arms and protecting one's community and one's country from outside folks and that sort of thing.
I would have to say first that I bought into that masculine framework that the military has. You know, that whole mythos, I guess, the whole structure of it growing up until I hit about fourth grade. And I don't remember what it was we were doing, but something my teacher said kind of broke that image.
In school, one of your teachers in school.
Yeah, my fourth grade teacher. So shout out to Mrs. Claire. She does real estate now. And so I also have to say that there were many girls and then later women who showed me early on that they were just as talented and more so than the boys and the men.
You said they got you together.
Me and my classmates.
Yeah.
And plus, you know, most of my teachers have been women. Most of my supervisors have been women.
Yeah.
So I have no trouble listening to women. None.
What would inspire you to pick up arms? To protect something, what would need to happen? We talk about the structural issues, not only in the arts, but here in the United States on this podcast, as racist as things are from not only the conception of classical music, I'm thinking about the prison industrial complex, I'm thinking about so many other things. What would need to happen for you to decide, as Kira Rudick has, to pick up a gun and protect what is yours?
Yeah. It's easy to say something like if my family was threatened.
Sure.
So if somebody that I love is threatened. But the only thing that I can say definitely for sure would inspire me to do that would be if somebody hurt radar. If anything like that, I could be moved to murder. So I think what I'm getting at is deep love. Mm-hmm. That agape sort of love.
The emotion that's tied to all of it.
Yeah.
What if we here living in the United States could have that depth of emotion and love for where we live? And this is this podcast is called Trilloquy, you know, so let's go there. Look, it's so hard for me to put myself in Kira Rudick's shoes because I don't feel that love of country because of everything that we have been through and all the conversations we need to have and the things that are continuing to be sidelined by the government, you know, much less reparations. I'm thinking about things like student loan cancellation and other ways in which the government, healthcare, universal healthcare, the many ways in which the United States government could help us have a reason to have that love. And look, I've lived and experienced many other international places. I can hear folks in the back of my head now, oh, well, you can't take for granted what it means to live in the United States, X, Y, and Z. I don't. And I understand what other people in other parts of the world go through and are going through, especially now in this time. And I think it's fair to have that conversation and look at what Kira Rudick is experiencing as far as love of country and obligation and dedication, and what would really have to happen for us, for more of us to have that feeling. Yeah, there are plenty of folks out there who are American flag waving, you know, my father was a Marine, I'm eighth generation Marine, whatever, you know, all of that is out there. I think that if we can find ways to help us have the same feeling as Kira Rudick, we're all going to be better. All citizens over here on the West, all of our boats are going to rise because there's something in it for us. There's something that is benefiting us. There's a genuine feeling of love that has been curated and cultivated based on that relationship between woman and country, man and country, individual and country. And just hearing Kira Rudick's words are inspiring to me. It helps me think about what a reality could look like where I want to pick up arms and protect something that is here, something, you know, that I have proximity to.
Let me ask you this. Is there any place on this planet that you have been that would even get close to inspiring that sort of behavior from you? Do you feel like you're a man without a country is what I'm asking right
oftentimes,
now? Really?
Oftentimes. And I've spent some time in some black countries, you know, down in the Caribbean, teaching music and getting embedded in with the culture and all that sort of thing. There's a pride that I envy when I'm in those parts of the world from the black folks there, you know?
Yeah,
and maybe that's what I'm getting at here. I'm almost envious of Kira's love and dedication to country.
I've said something similar about religion, that, you know, if I look at the fervent people and I go, I want to believe in something that strongly.
Yeah.
I've been wondering this a couple of times, if there was a place where you felt like you would be at home.
We have to create that space. And I think that's why these conversations are so useful in art spaces. We talk about diversity and, you know, renewing audiences and all that sort of thing. I feel like what we need to really dig into and understand is that we're blazing a trail in many ways. I'm in the middle of some consultation right now with the San Francisco Symphony Orchestra. And one of the questions that I ask, inspired by the conversation that we had on Trilloquy, that I had on Trilloquy with Daniel Bernard Romain, shout out to him, is what are the diverse spaces in our world? When do you, Scott, feel like you are in a space that is representative of the diversity that surrounds you here in the United States? You're not a churchgoer or anything, but, you know, places of religion are one of the last places where we see some of that diversity, right?
Sure.
Someone in the equity training from San Francisco Symphony mentioned sporting events. She likes football and going to football games, and there is a level of diversity that's represented there. So, you know, while it's not completely unprecedented, truly diverse spaces, I think it's something that we have to create. When you ask me, you know, do I feel like a man without a country? You know, where would the place be? I feel like it's right here, but we have to create something new. And conversations like we have here on this podcast, they center the arts. But if we can all just, you know, again, as we repeat, have these conversations and let that reverberate to our respective communities and constituencies, we can see some of that. We will be able to love country, all of us. You know, none of us will be marginalized, and we can all love country as much as Kira Rudick does. Mm. I'm inspired by her, especially to be saying what she is saying on women's history during Women's History Month and on International Women's Day, really empowering other women who have those feelings to do what they believe is right. There are so many refugees out of Ukraine, and as we've already mentioned, other parts of the world where they have to leave everything they know behind, including their spouses, some of their family, loved ones, you know, all of that sort of thing. And in light of all of that, you have folks like Kira Rudick inspiring so many of us. So huge shout out to her. Welcome to Opus 141 of Trilloquy. Let's go ahead and get into it.
I'm Scott Blankenship.
And this is Trilloquy, Opus 141. To returning listeners, thank you so much for coming back and continuing to support this project of ours. To new listeners, if you've never tuned into the Trilloquy podcast before, Trilloquy is a podcast that takes the phrase classical music and affirms the historical truth surrounding it, that the things that you approximate to that phrase, even your oral definitions of classical music, are the result of white supremacist conditioning. So here on this podcast, we take that truth and reframe the phrase classical music, the pieces of music that we approximate to that phrase, and even the conversations surrounding that phrase classical music, all toward the ultimate goal of decolonizing classical music so that we all can affirm the unique Americanness of what we have contributed to the world of classical music. So, you know, again, Scott, Kira Rudick, I'm sure there's so much Ukrainian music that she can speak to and is proud to highlight as a part of Ukrainian's classic tradition of music. Mm-hmm. We have the same thing here in the United States, but it has not ever, or it's at least rarely, has been approximated to that phrase classical music. When we talk about all of the unique contributions that we as Americans have offered, again, to the world of classical music. So anyway, this is what all of that is what this podcast is about. So for more information, visit trilloquy.org. You can listen to past opuses there. You can also find out how you can contribute to the Trilloquy podcast. In addition to your support for Trilloquy comes from Springboard for the Arts, a local arts institution here in St. Paul, Minnesota, ensuring that artists have a means of creating a living and a life. More information on them at springboardforthearts.org. I would also like to send a special thank you to the Schwab School of Music down in Columbus, Georgia. Scott, their airport has three whole gates. It's a small town with a lot of big talent at the School of Music. Thank you to Dr. Patterson for having me down to the Schwab School of Music to not only lead a masterclass with the Bassoon Studio, I also have the pleasure of speaking at the school's convocation. So I'm there radicalizing the whole student body. Wow. And I also have the great opportunity to speak with the Black Schwab Society down there at the Schwab School of Music. So huge shout out and thank you to everyone down at the Schwab School of Music in Columbus, Georgia. And I would, to round out this week's announcements, I want to send a special shout out and thank you to Anne. I don't know if Anne wants me sharing her full government here on the podcast, but I'll just say thank you to Anne. She is affiliated, is a board member of Orchestra Iowa, and coming up, they're going to perform Joel Thompson's Seven Last Words of the Unarmed, which when I told you before we turned on the microphones, you acted like that was a surprise to you. Is that something that you're surprised to hear coming out of Iowa?
In that corner, sure.
Yeah, Cedar Rapids area, I believe.
I'm not too surprised. How about nicely surprised?
Sure. Anyway, so Anne wrote this really touching article that speaks to her experiences and why she believes that it's important for Orchestra Iowa to be doing this. And I'm actually named in this article. So I'm gonna read a little bit of this before we get into the first movement. She writes here, "I had first heard Garrett McQueen on the air a couple years ago. There was a deep resonance in his voice that immediately made me think, he sounds Black." Which, first of all, I love, because you you have no idea. You can only imagine how many times I've met someone and they're like, "Oh, you look a little different than I was expecting," or whatever language they'll use to say that they didn't think I was Black. Anyway, I appreciated seeing that. Anyway, she says, "That immediately made me think, he sounds Black," in parentheses, which I confirmed with a quick check online. "I have been listening to classical music on the radio since junior high school, and in the four decades since, could not have recalled having heard a Black host even once. A bassoonist who had performed with symphonies throughout the United States, McQueen said it was after hearing Seven Last Words of the Unarmed that he, quote, decided to leave the stage and fight for racial equity through classical music. I admired his style of advocacy. Much to my dismay, McQueen and APM parted ways in August of 2020. She goes into that and she says, "I found the timing to be unfortunate, but she was very happy to see that I was continuing as executive producer and co-host of the Trilloquy podcast." She writes, "There was a period when the last thing I would say nearly every evening was, 'Alexa, play Iowa Public Radio Classical.' My habits changed with the departure of McQueen, and there is a lingering sadness for me that his voice is missing from the regular lineup. That now strikes me as ironic, since I did not know there was a void in my life until I heard McQueen on air." That choked me up this morning. Wow. I was sitting here at my desk tearing up. I'm trying not to tear up right now. And I just want to thank Ann. It's so easy, and all of the work that all of us do, as I was speaking to in the very opening, we can get bogged down by all the work of it. And sometimes we can forget the impact of the work that we're doing. So I just want to send a personal thank you to Anne. I hope that the performance of Joel Thompson's Seven Last Words of the Unarmed is not only treated with the respect and reverence it deserves. I hope that arts institution and arts institutions everywhere can understand that also that's not his only piece of music. Mm-hmm. It's not only about Black mm-hmm. trauma, mm-hmm. right?
Right.
Impact can happen in many ways. So thank you, Anne. Thank you, everyone down at Orchestra Iowa. And thank you again to everyone listening. Let's get into movement one. Last week, we talked about some of the arts professionals who have different employment statuses based on
suddenly
their proximity mm-hmm. to Russia and Putin and all of those folks. So I just want to throw up a quick natural to offer an update. We did a lot of talking last week about Anna Netrebko. I just want to mention that Valerie Gergiev has now been fired as chief conductor in Munich. I'll read just a little bit here. It says, "Valerie Gergiev, the star Russian maestro and prominent supporter of President Vladimir Putin of Russia, was removed Tuesday from his post as chief conductor of the Munich Philharmonic after he refused to denounce Mr. Putin's invasion of Ukraine." I'll let y'all read the rest of that. But what I just want to ask you real quick, Scott, is, again, why is this important? Is this sort of decision by the Munich Philharmonic consequential in some big way? Is it more value driven? What can you offer as far as why this is something important for arts institutions to stand firm in their decisions like the Munich Philharmonic made?
I see one of these side stories too. It says that Gergiev also has lost Carnegie Hall engagements.
Mm-hmm.
So it's going back to that idea of the company you keep.
Right.
I got out of Wells Fargo because they have money in that pipeline.
Yeah.
I forget the name of the pipeline now. The credit union I'm at has no money in it. So
yeah.
I go there. The company you keep, if you stop buying things that are put out by a person or a company that has values opposite yours,
mm-hmm.
You might not think that has the impact, but what if a whole bunch of you that think that you don't have that kind of impact start doing it, and they start feeling it in the pocketbook?
Yeah.
Then they're going to start paying attention. Yeah.
You mentioned the pocketbook. I feel like for so long in arts institutions, there are decisions like these that weren't made because of the pocketbook. Again, last week we mentioned James Levine.
Mm-hmm.
It took decades to get him out of here. And even so, I feel like there are still people who debate, try to have the art versus artist mm-hmm. conversation and
sure.
and all of those sorts of things.
Sure.
With this considered, you know, how the Munich Philharmonic is responding to Gergiev, would you say we're in or approaching a new era of arts institutions not seeing themselves as neutral parties? Has, in your 30 years of broadcast, can you think of other examples of separation from certain individuals because of political or global issues? Or is this a new thing that we're seeing? From my perspective, it sort of is.
Yeah, it was always the 800-pound gorilla in the room, you know, mm-hmm. whatever political thing was going on with whatever you were playing. It just wasn't acknowledged in my time,
mm-hmm.
at least at the places that I've worked up to this point. The other idea, you know, we talked last time about how all of the Putin-sympathetic artists have been removed from the classical NPR playlists.
Yeah.
Does that have a big impact? I don't know. But it doesn't further it
sure.
either.
Sure.
So a good example is, you know, like I don't pass along memes, or when I was on Facebook, I didn't pass along memes that I thought was funny within my circles that might do damage elsewhere.
Right.
I didn't want to contribute to that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so fine. It doesn't have that big of an impact if you don't hear Valery Gergiev on classical NPR anymore, but you're not going to hear his name on our air.
Sure.
That's the idea, you know, you're not... Not that it's going to dent their career, but you're just not going to hear it here.
What's been the approach in your work to Russian music generally? How is the break surrounding Tchaikovsky or Rachmaninoff or Shostakovich or Prokofiev, you know, all these people? How is that being handled? I'm curious.
For me?
Yeah.
I don't have any problem. Yeah, with Tchaikovsky, are you talking about trying to line it up now or?
Yeah, I mean, because a lot, again, especially when we're talking about romantic era Western classical
yeah.
music, there's a, we lean heavy
yeah.
on Russia. So I wonder what that's looking like.
Yeah, it's great to be able to tell the stories about the ones that worked in exile, about the ones who had their work completely suppressed while authoritarian regimes were in place.
Sure,
you know?
Sure.
And then, you know, you can see that hard shift, like when the regime ended,
yeah.
then all of a sudden the music changes as well.
Yeah. You know how they say saved by the bell? A lot of these composers have been saved by death, because I'm thinking about Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, who was a military general first.
That's right.
Before being a composer.
A naval officer.
I wonder how these conversations would be different if some of these folks were still alive. I talked about Prokofiev last week. We have it on paper that he stood against Stalin and the oppressive Russian regime all the way to the end, all the way to death.
Mm.
We also have the story about how not all Russian composers felt that way during the time.
Right.
I can't help but to think that maybe it wouldn't be. I'm not trying to put any words on none of y'all's favorite composers, but I think it's of note, at least worth conversation, to think about the fact that some of these folks, some of these composers who we worship, would not have, I would say they would be joining Gergiev and Netrebko and all of these people, if we're really being honest about the history that we know and understand about these composers.
You think Rimsky-Korsakov would have?
Do you honestly think that a naval general would have defected and stood against Putin or whoever when, if he were alive today? I don't know if I can say that.
I don't know. There's Hunt for Red October.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Well, listen, they're not here. So like I said, right. saved by death. We don't have to worry about canceling them necessarily, but thoughts and prayers to everybody.
It's easy with some of them. And like we were talking at dinner last week, I'm not overt with my breaks. I treat all the information like just things laid out on a platter, and I just set it in front of you and let you think about it.
Well, I'm not on live radio these days, but I'm sure you can imagine.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go ahead and transition.
All right.
Last week, we didn't hear the Ukrainian national anthem, so I thought we would pull it out this week. This is actually an excerpt from it as performed by the New York Philharmonic.
Thank you.
an excerpt there of the Ukrainian national anthem as performed by members of the New York Philharmonic. I love, Scott, listening to the national anthems of other countries, especially the ones that dig into some of that minor tonality. I know we're playing a little bit of inside baseball here, but when you get into that minor key, it reminds me of the struggles of a people and what they have gone through. I'm thinking about the Israeli national anthem as we hear it in the Moldau by Smetana. Mm. Or I'm thinking about, I don't believe Finlandia is the national anthem of Finland, but you know, that piece of music, how that digs into that emotion. Again, exactly what you were talking about with Kira Rudick. So thoughts and prayers isn't even the right phrase. Just my heart goes out to everyone in Ukraine and around the world who are being impacted by imperialist violence. Some of that violence as instigated by the United States, if we're going to keep it real, in other parts of the world, not necessarily sure. Ukraine, yeah. You know, but my heart goes out to all of these people. I hope that we can all find ways to engage these conversations, to learn about what's going on for the sake of future peace. We don't have peace right now. I do believe, though, that we can see it. If we all just put our minds together, offer some creativity into the conversation and approach it in every way we can. All right. Well, to lighter things, you wanted to talk a little bit about a violinist who you've brought into the Trilloquy conversation before. How about you take it away?
Right.
But what accidental is this going to give?
This is going to be a sharp. This is an update. I think it was Opus 59 you said that.
I believe so, yeah.
That I brought in music by Ezinma. She is a classically trained violinist. And this update here is she has been working on a new initiative called Strings by Heart, which aims to bring more diversity, access, and inclusion to the classical music world through music education programs. Now, her name is listed, you know, this is a who's who of who in all the people she's performed with.
Mm-hmm.
Beyonce, Yo-Yo Ma, SZA. Is that
SZA? Yeah, we need to catch you up with what's hip. Anyway,
Kendrick Lamar and Joshua Bell.
Just real quick, okay? Of all you read those names in order. Whose name was first?
Beyonce.
Anyway, go on. Just want to, you know.
Beyonce was also in the title,
and not Ezinma's name, and that was a part of my issue. Look, I stand. Everybody that listens to this podcast and knows me personally knows that I stand. I also understand clickbait and wanting people to read the article that you wrote. I call foul when it comes to not naming Ezinma in the name in the title of this article. I won't linger there for long because that's not what this is about. But
right.
I just felt like I needed to name that, and that among artists like Yo-Yo Ma and Joshua Bell, Beyonce is named first, as she should be. Go on, Scott.
Reading on further, her motivation for starting the foundation stems from her own personal experiences of music education. She says, "I remember the isolation I felt as the only Black person in the orchestra, at times discouraged by my teachers from pursuing my dreams." I should point out, she is a native of Lincoln, Nebraska.
Okay, shout out to Nebraska.
So I think that also speaks to the school system that she was a part of.
Yeah.
But so her point is, statistics are clear that music education plays a vital role in helping children and young adults get on the path to achieve their goals, improve self-esteem, and more.
Yeah. I'm thinking about something that the composer Brittany J. Green brought up last week in the third movement, the idea of setting up young people for success or failure. So while I honor what Ezinma is doing and getting young children of color, young Black kids to be able to engage string playing in a way that's culturally competent, they're actually engaging it through music that is a part of their lives now, or music that speaks to them. Mm-hmm. I think that's very important. At the same time, Scott, I wonder if you, what your thoughts are as far as what we're setting up those kids for, considering the fact that those sorts of aesthetics, that approach to instrumental playing, to string playing, isn't reaffirmed in colleges or by arts institutions. So what are we leading them to with this entry point?
I don't know. I would go into it with the hope that they would create something new with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's my hope.
That the young people would be 18 years old and create
something brand new.
Yeah.
A new aesthetic.
Do you get what I'm saying, though?
I do.
That they don't have an infrastructure to continue to thrive under when they're done with their third grade violin class with Ezinma. Where else is that approach being affirmed? I think that's something that we have to address when we create these new initiatives to get young people into the fold. We're getting them into the fold to do what? And if it doesn't exist yet, who is there to create those infrastructures? Because it's not fair, I don't think, to ask these young people or to expect of these young people the creation of their new thing when, you know, we all benefit from some sort of structure that formed us within arts ecosystems. I just think it has to be named that we still don't have structures for when they grow up under which they can be affirmed and grow and develop even further.
I have to come at it from the perspective of this will inspire more. And when we have more of it, then the structure begins to take shape and you have more success stories. And plus, it's a positive step in this direction. So I have to support it.
Yeah.
Because what if one person takes part in a program like this and they become the one that is the catalyst for change?
Yeah.
What if you don't take every shot you've got, you miss a potential hit.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a shot.
Yeah.
It's a shot for somebody. It's small. You know, you often say, look, I feel like I've got a knife 6 inches in my back, and you tell me you want to pull it out 3 inches.
Yeah, Malcolm X said that, yeah.
Okay, well, okay, and you've repeated it to me, so that's where I got it. But all I'm saying is, so does that mean that I shouldn't try to pull it the 3 inches?
I think that—
Is that being naive?
Well, to continue the point that Malcolm X was making, he was saying that we take that knife out 3 inches and we consider that progress, even though there's still a knife in my back.
Right.
So it's progress. Yeah. So it's progress for whom? I guess. And again, shout out and congratulations to Ezinma. This is very important work, and I do believe that it's important to create equitable approaches to those entry points. Mm-hmm. I affirm that. I also think it's unfair to grab these young people and create equitable entry points for them when the path ahead is a waterfall, when it's a cliff under which, you know, and they're going to jump off of it and there's nothing there to catch them as far as being affirmed culturally, not even with what they're learning under Ezinma. I just think that conversation needs to be had. And I think folks in positions of power on other links in the chain, when we talk about especially the conservatories and the schools of music after grade school, and then, of course, even getting into the profession. It's not fair to these young people, in my opinion, for them not to have a place to go that relates to that entry point.
I see where you're coming from. I understand. And I hadn't thought that far downriver toward the waterfall. I looked at it as this will be an opportunity for someone.
Yeah.
Even if it isn't even this first round, you know, of the beginning stages, you know.
And Ezinma was I'll go to the article. She says here, or the writer writes, Black and Latinx musicians are historically underrepresented in classical orchestras, making up less than 4% of orchestra members. That's Black and Latinidad,
right.
You know, so that's all of the Black and brown folks here,
right,
in the United States. So Ezinma answered the call. This is how she's answering the call. So, you know, I honor that. And all the conversations I'm having surrounding this, I honor that. I wonder for you, in a similar way that Kira from over in the Ukraine took up arms, I wonder what you would need to take up these sorts of proverbial arms. You think that what she's doing here is a great first step.
Mm-hmm.
What resources do you think you would need personally to say, okay, I'm going to step away from the microphone and I'm going to offer another stepping stone? They have the entry point. I need to create this. What do you think you need to see or have or experience for it to be possible for you to make that professional leap? The budget. You see how capitalism continues to oppress us? See, the system understands that there are certain things that we can't do without that dollar.
Right.
You know, and that's why that conversation, I believe, is coming quicker and quicker to art spaces,
because
it's a conversation that we can't really ignore for too much longer. Just as Brittany J. Green, again, shout out to her, said last week, it's a combination. It all has to equal 100, but it's a combination of talent, hard work, money, and luck. And I can definitely affirm those last two things, the money and the luck, are definitely needed. So yeah. What if money didn't have to be a part of the conversation? Think about how many more opportunities we would have for that many more people. Think about all the folks who would create these infrastructures, these orchestras, these schools of music, where folks who have this type of entry point can feel affirmed along the whole journey and not just say in retrospect, oh, well, I started out playing Beyonce and doing all this stuff, but there isn't really a place for me to do that. So here I am with Brahms or whatever, you know. So I believe that, you know, all of that to say, that conversation is very important. The way that money plays a role in this and the ways in which entry points are used to fortify the traditional structure and the traditional aesthetic of classical music. We have to have that conversation.
I think that initiatives like this, if things like this are done properly and successfully, that they can be an example of something more robust being put into place. So then maybe we have the structure that you're talking about.
Right.
I have to get behind something like this just because there's a possibility for somebody.
And I get behind it as well because I'm rooting for everybody black. That's rooting for everybody black. I hope everyone changes that phrase to that. I'm rooting for everybody black. That's rooting for everybody black. And Ezinma is among them. I have to respect it. I respect the hustle. So
yeah, and last year I did send her an email thanking her for her music and seeing if she wanted to come on the podcast. She did not respond. So here,
she didn't respond to you.
And let me do my Bernie Sanders again. I am once again asking if you will come on the podcast.
All right. Well, you'll have to interview her then. Are you going to be ready? Are you going to be prepared?
I figured you'd want to do that.
so you're creating an entry point for me now. You're creating work for me.
Yeah, because that's what you need. Yeah, sure.
Shout out to Ezinma. A huge congrats on all of the progress and all of the work you're doing. Here's a track of hers titled Ode to Hustle for us to honor her work with. Ode to Hustle featuring Ezinma on violin. I hesitate to ask my usual question because I know the usual answer, but to the point I was making, y'all not gonna play that on the radio. So what are we doing introducing kids to that sort of aesthetic and to that sort of cross-pollination of aesthetics and musical styles if it's not being reaffirmed anywhere? Not to say that it shouldn't be done and that entry point shouldn't happen. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is we have to think about that, that we have built the boat and put it on the river, but there's a waterfall down there where everybody's just going to fall off and die. I don't think that conversation is being had.
What would happen if the organizations that wanted to keep on doing that just came out and said, all right, we're going to be the Western canon organization.
I wish they
radio
would.
Station, blah, 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 blah.
Wish they would.
So does that create, what opportunity does that create?
Well, it sheds light on what the truth is. We were talking about several weeks ago, I don't know if you remember the Society for the Preservation of Western Music, you know, how they are upfront about what they're here to do and what they're here to support. I feel like the majority of arts institutions, I'm talking about 90% of them, are that, but don't want to allege to be that because they understand the racism in saying that, but they don't understand the racism in acting on those sorts of Western European norms when it comes to music. Anyway, it's a very nuanced conversation, and thank goddess that we have women like Ezinma out here challenging the status quo by creating more diverse entry points for more diverse students to begin their musical journeys. And I'm a pray for them, and I'm a pray for these students because goodness gracious, the stuff that we all have gone through in our journeys as Western classically trained musicians of color, goodness gracious, is I think I think there are conversations happening among the youth. And when I say that, I mean like early college age kids, conversations happening now that we didn't have, and certainly that you didn't have back in 19. Yeah. So I'm hopeful, but we can't take this and separate it from the pathway, from the ecosystem. We have to think about what's downriver.
Just as initiatives like Ezinma's working on, if we have more of them doing things successfully, they get more robust and there's that structure put in place. I think it's going to take somebody at an orchestra or radio station, opera company, actually stepping out and going, okay, we're going to be daring. If you have more organizations doing that, it becomes easier to do it.
The company you keep, and no one wants to be first.
Right, right. So now we were talking last week, yes. look at the Met.
Yeah.
You know, when they, and it took them what, 5 days to cut ties with Netrebko?
Yeah.
Okay, and we said, now that's it. They're not off the hook for everything up to that.
Right.
This is like, okay, one good decision. Now let's see what you do.
Yeah.
I think that's what it's going to take.
And that's a part of activism, is being that example for other people. So speaking of, you know, making sure that the pathway is equitable, you know, so many kids come in and have to dampen their own experience, maybe even whiten their own experience or their own perspectives for the sake of the art form. Well, there's a musical. I saved this article a few weeks ago. I decided to go ahead and bring it in. There's a musical that explores that concept in a really interesting theoretical way. I'm going to give this a sharp for being provocative. This is coming from National Public Radio, NPR. The title, A Machine Turns Black People White in the musical Black No More. Goodness gracious. I can't even. Well, I mean, before I read anything, what's your reaction to that? And I'll go ahead and tell you, it's based on a book. Mm-hmm. It's based on an Afro-futurist book. What are your ideas about that as a concept, a machine that will turn black folks white?
Right around.
I mean, because the machine I'm thinking about is the classical music industrial complex. Anyway.
Oh, right around 2003, I was in a play at the Shelter Belt Theater that was part of our Halloween vignettes show. So 5 to 7 minute sketches. And in one of them, this man is brought home from the bar by four women.
Okay.
And the scene was called Sex Change. And they had this device. They were going to put him in there. And if you're a man, it turns you into a woman. If you're a woman, it turns you into a man. Mm-hmm. So they put him in there, and he comes out as a woman. Oh, my God, what are you? Oh, no, this is crazy. We have to go. Let us check it out and see if it's actually working. And then they go in and turn into men.
Okay.
And they come out, and they're like, what? What? We thought you wanted to come back to our place and fool around. What?
Oh, and now all of a sudden he's like, oh, no, wait a minute.
Right, now this
is. You see? Anyway, yeah. Let me read here. A new musical.
Is that what you were talking about?
Yep. A new musical inspired by a satirical Afrofuturist novel called Black No More opens off-Broadway Tuesday. This was last month, presented by The New Group. Set during the Depression, both the book and the musical examine race in America with an outrageous plot device. An inventor comes up with a machine that turns black people white. The musical is written by Tariq Trotter, who's known by many as Black Thought. It says here, Trotter wrote the lyrics and music of much of the music, which ranges from hip hop to R&B to jazz to folk. Again, lots of American classical portrayed here and celebrated on stage. It goes on to say he plays Dr. Junius Crookman, inventor of the Black No More machine, which will turn any black person white for $50. Trotter says the doctor believes that this Black No More device is the solution to race relations in America. I think the line is to solve the American race problem as we know it. But yeah, you know, I don't think a solution is ever reached.
I thought you were going to say the doctor felt the fee was low.
Oh, yeah, because I guess that's, you know, what your experience is worth, $50. You know, reparations is much more than that. Okay, so let's, I'm being problematic today. But
based on the first paragraph, the first few sentences of the first paragraph that you read,
yeah,
would you go see it based on those first few lines?
I would definitely. And, you know, like I said, this was in February. This was last month. But I think that's something very provocative and actually speaks to something that exists in the world. I find this provocative because so many infrastructures and institutions, most certainly Western classical music, want Black folks to do just that, show up to their spaces white. Now, of course, not with white skin, but with a perspective and with sensibilities that center white people. Again, we think about neutrality a lot in art spaces, but neutrality, a default, all of those things as being white is the very definition of white supremacy. So I think this is a provocative idea. I need to read the book. I think this musical is provocative in that it, in an outlandish way, explores that very idea, what people are dealing with, what Black folks, what folks of color are dealing with in the industry today.
Anything that puts you in the opposite shoes, right, is going to have sort of an eye-opening effect, right? And when you take something that's the default, like the presumed sexuality of somebody just based on appearance or values based on the skin color or whatever, and you flip the script, I don't know, I think it could be effective. I was just curious if in the first few lines that you read, if that was going to raise your eyebrows enough to be problematic enough to keep you away from it.
Well, and it definitely will be one thing if we were talking about white leads in a play about Black folks being turned white. I mean, that would be way out here. But I think, you know, the producers and the original author was smart enough to frame this in a way for us to actually be able to have the conversation. Look, I'll read again. Well, I won't read, but one of the ideas behind the play is that this doctor who has created this machine believes that this is the way to solve the world's problems. You see, I feel like this is what arts institutions want out of people of color and out of our experiences. I feel like they want us to not bring our full selves because our audience or because of our bottom line or our board of directors, or, you know, whatever excuse you want to fill in. They believe that all of these problems that they see in DEI would be solved if we wouldn't go there. But at the end of the day, there's so many things that racism fuels that wouldn't go away with this whitening of society as it is in this play, and even the way we think about music in our art spaces. I'm thinking about the patriarchy, misogyny, you know, I'm thinking about homophobia, I'm thinking about capitalism, as we have already mentioned. All of these things work in tandem with racism. So I think I want to see this because I want to see how that conversation is addressed, and if it is addressed in this work of art.
How poorly would you have to think of yourself to go and say, yeah, I'll change to a different race?
Okay, but let me swap what you have just said. How deep and how violent is the conditioning, the environment for a person to think of themselves in that way? Yeah. See, I feel like we can't put the onus, even I haven't even seen the play, but I feel like you can't put the onus on these people who might want to pay their little $50 because there's an environment that breeds that thinking, that breeds that desire out of a person.
Yeah.
Let me just go ahead and ask you, what about a white no more machine? Are you going to go sit in the chair and turn black? I wish y'all could see Scott's face. Go ahead.
I never do this to you. Never.
All right. Well, that's your answer from Scott. So go. Oh, unless you.
I just said I did not. No, I wouldn't. And is there any guarantee that my life would improve if I jumped into the machine? Am I jumping into the machine so I can get into, are we flipping the script that the Black society now is the one that has supremacy?
There are so many points, you know, there's so much here to unpack, more than we have time for today, but even your asking that question, you know, it reminds me of what I want to say to so many people of color is like, do you really think your life is going to be better if you dedicate yourself to a Western thinking around classical music, if you dedicate your life to white supremacist infrastructures? I feel like that's the mode of thinking, the line of thinking that this play, this musical inspires. At least it inspires me. I'm going to see if it's streaming somewhere. Mm. I need to go buy this book because these are the conversations, Scott. You see how uncomfortable it can get very quickly when we have these sorts of conversations? Thank goodness for artists, for creators who dig into that discomfort, into those sort of gritty conversations, and create things for us to enjoy musically.
There's a quote from an old film that goes, "Be leery of business opportunities that require a change of wardrobe."
Mm-hmm.
I would be even more leery of something that required me to change my skin tone.
Okay, so you said change of wardrobe. What did these orchestras want all these musicians to wear?
What, they're dressed black and white?
Okay, so that is something that folks have, just tucks and tails. Do you have tucks and tails at home?
To go to a concert? No, I don't have it.
Okay, so that means to enter that infrastructure as a musician, you would have to change something about your wardrobe, correct? So what did you say? Be leery of, what was the quote?
Business opportunities that require a change of wardrobe.
There it is.
But more broadly, changing yourself. I think it's about altering yourself to fit into something else for some perceived reward.
If any of y'all have read this book or have seen this article, yeah, please reach out because it's a lot. It sounds like a lot. So to transition out of this first movement to get us into the second movement, we're going to hear from the man who wrote all this music in this very provocative sounding musical based on this very provocative book. Again, Tariq Trotter, who's known by many others as Black Thought. This is a tune of his called Thought Versus Everybody. Let's take a listen to get us into the second movie.
I don't think you heard the most powerful black man in the world.
Hey, y'all. They ask why I seem so solemn on a throne between three stone columns. You know the name, fucking up the game, no condoms. Everybody goddamn first world problem. The truth is inconvenient as non-believers. Fearing DACA dreamers instead of FEMA. Bentley Benz or a Beamer, Fiji or Aquafina. We fuck around and be the next Iwo Jima. The tides rising at the same time like they synchronize. For making art, for making love, for making highs. The home is where the hatred lies. They taking lives, but everybody just so saved and sanctified.
We might, Scott, we might have to return. We might have to return to this conversation because it's so much deeper than what we're really getting into today. I mean, there are so many cognitive things that you can connect with that sort of plot. So many real world professional aspects of the conversation. Again, as we were talking about with the clothes you wear, who you show up into art spaces in, culturally and sensibly when it comes to what you consider excellent music, the greatest music, and all of these phrases that we use in art spaces, we may have to return to it. But for now, we're here in the second movement where Scott and I are taking a piece of music that we have been spending some time with this week. And instead of repeating it fully, we take the second ending and talk a little bit about why we were vibing with it so much all week. How about you go first? Who you got this week?
I wanted to shine the light on composer Julia Wolfe, and in particular, a recording that was put out with the Bang on a Can ensemble called Field Recordings. While I was working on my house, I had music going in the background, and it was obviously pulling some things from my history. And that man playing the one-note flute and humming with it, it's some sort of an African technique.
Yeah.
And that came through. And then a couple randoms down, Julia Wolfe's piece called Reeling comes up. Do you know the piece?
I don't.
Okay, so part of this Field Recordings thing with Bang on a Can, it says it's rooted in the mystery of experimentation as it is in collaborative spirit. In the words of composer David Lang, it's kind of a ghost story. We ask composers from different parts of the music world to find a recording of something that already exists, a voice, a sound, a faded scrap of melody, and write a new piece around it. So I was thinking
of sounds like sampling to me.
Sure. Or if you want to go back to like what Béla Bartók did, you know, recording Roma music from the Hungarian countryside, that sort of thing, and threaded it into a new composition. And Reeling Julia said that this piece starts off with a French Canadian singer, and it's just sort of nonsense words, you know, just you know, this sort of thing. And it's so catchy the way that it started off that it actually made me sit up and, you know, kind of turn around and look at the speaker a little bit. And I love this ensemble, the way that they start snapping fingers together and they get it in their body. So I love that they can keep this together. And then the clarinetist comes in ever so gently, like a breath, like slowly bringing in the volume. So they start handing it around, right? And that cello, that looks like Darth Vader's cello. That's one of those carbon jobs, right?
Yeah, I like this. This is,
you know what I really, you know what I love about the sample though?
What's that?
They left that breath in. You know, I felt myself breathing along with the vocalist.
I mean, is that not a part of the performance? A vocalist has to breathe, right? So that's a part of it.
Right. I just love how it wasn't disguised or minimized in any way.
The name Julia Wolfe, was that a new name for you? I'm familiar with some of her work.
I had heard her name here and there, but I couldn't give you a title.
Okay.
Yeah, I just know the name.
Well, let's hear a little bit of this outro. Shout out to Reeling by Julia Wolfe and everyone over at Bang on a Can. There's some heroes as well, because a lot of the music they put out is really stretching what these, again, challenging these conceptions of classical music. Really important work being done by Bang on a Can. Let's check out the final bits of this performance of Reeling by Julia Wolfe. And I'm just now understanding the title, Reeling, as in reels of tape and that sort of thing. Very cool. I like that.
Well, also, you know, typically in Irish music, they have reels, you know, jigs and reels and things like that. So perhaps that's in there too.
Yeah. Wow. Julia Wolfe, ladies and gentlemen. Really, really great stuff. I can't wait to revisit that myself. All right. Well, for me this week, Scott, I've been doing a lot of traveling and going here and there. So I've been trying to catch up on all of my news and my podcasts and things. And for Women's History Month, I heard a show, and I'm sorry that I'm not remembering who this was, but I heard a show and there were some folks honoring the work of Martha Wash. Now,
yes.
When I say that name, you know exactly who I'm talking about, but you have to admit that a lot of folks don't. Even though they know her sound, they have heard music with her voice on it, but they don't know her name. As a matter of fact, let's go ahead and remind people of the most famous performance of Martha Wash. How many times have you done that in your DJ days? I mean, would that go? Would that get the people moving?
Every show, every dance.
So the woman singing there is Martha Wash, and she's not featured in the music video.
No.
She's not, and she wasn't even credited from what I was reading today. Doesn't get royalties or residuals from that performance. Why do you think that is, Scott? Why do you think that Martha Wash was sidelined, marginalized, put in the background in that way?
I'll tell you what she said in an interview that I saw. She said it was because she was heavy. And when she was with the Weather Girls, I mean, they put out some disco anthems.
Yeah.
And I ran across her when they used her voice in Everybody, Everybody by Black Box, which is the song that I use to teach everybody the electric slide. You won't belong to me, I let you down.
You, not you teaching people the electric slide. What?
Come on.
Anyway, this is my second move. Anyway, so all of that to say, shout out to Martha Wash. So
also CNC Music Factory, Everybody Dance Now.
All of that to say, her voice is one that people know and might not know her name. So I wanted to go back and see if there was some Martha Wash original, some more music, some more contemporary music that I need to check out that showcases her voice and showcases her name connected to the voice. So she came out with an album a few years back called Something Good. That's the title of the album. And I've been listening to the different tracks on the album. And the tune that resonated with me the most was called I'm Not Coming Down. It seems like one of those anthems that, from my perspective, says, look, I know that y'all were sidelining and marginalizing me for all these years. Well, you know what? I'm still here. My star is shining. I'm up and I'm not coming down. So I really appreciated being able to not only remind myself of her very important legacy, but to listen to some of her new music, some of her new compositions. So here's a little bit of I'm Not Coming Down featuring Martha Wash.
Some days I'd fight for every breath. Sometimes I'd shake with every step.
Not quite the disco vibe, right?
But, no.
But very inspirational, very American classical, if I may. We had the guitar, we had the piano and all of that stuff. Brilliant music. I was so happy to find, first of all, again, to hear someone still saying her name, and then B, to find this music. This album came out back in 2013, so almost a decade ago, but much more contemporary than some of the other disco and dance music that made her voice famous, if not her name. So women's history, Martha Wash is one of those names that we need to be saying, not only in March, of course, but year round, but especially in March, as we remember the contributions that many women have put out into the field of American classical music. Shout out to Martha Wash. We honor you.
It sounded to me like the music for a montage in a film.
Sure.
Or maybe from a TV series.
Sure. Sure. But you have to admit that we all have those TV shows or series that we watch where the montage is where we get into our feelings.
Exactly.
That's when we cry. It's during the montage.
That's right.
You know?
That's right.
Yeah.
We should bring that back. Let's bring the montage back.
Bring the montage back.
Yeah.
I mean, even let's have the Martha Wash documentary. That montage is going to be something. Yeah. And we already have the music to go with it. So anyway, again, shout out to Martha Wash. We're transitioning here into the third movement. This week's guest is Kamala Sankaram. So coming up next week, Scott, the Washington National Opera at the Kennedy Center is presenting Written in Stone, a series of new operas. One of the operas is written by Carlos Simon, member of the Trilloquy family there. And it's a set of operas that sort of challenge the idea of monuments, if not challenge the idea centers the conversation of what should be written in stone. We are an evolving, ever-changing people with nuance and different sensibilities and all that sort of thing. So should anything really be written in stone? Anyway, one of the operas, Rise, is actually composed by music composed by Kamala Sankaram. So she comes to talk a little bit about this upcoming opera, the idea of things written in stone. And we even get a little bit into a little Indian music. I think the microphones were cut off when we started talking about the veena specifically. But she actually said that she was supposed to be a veena player as a kid, but the sitar was a little bit more known to folks here in the United States. She grew up over in California. That was a little bit more known. So that's more of the direction she went in. But all sorts of cross-pollination and a really great conversation here. Where we start, I basically just revisit one of the conversations, one of the questions we always explore here, redefining classical music. What is classical music? What are your ideas around that phrase? A question I asked Kamala, considering her background and her knowledge of classical musics around the world. So to get us into the conversation, I'm going to play a track that features her band. They're called Bombay Rickey. And this tune is called Electric by Ravi. So music here by Bombay Rickey featuring Kamala Sankaram to get me into my conversation with Kamala. Hope y'all enjoy.
You can feel the sting of their sublime. My parents divorced when I was a small kid. And so most of my experience with musical training up until I was a teenager was really around learning to play the piano and then, you know, choral music. And so my exposure to Indian music was in the times that I spent with my dad on those like supervised visit, not supervised visit. That's the wrong term of the days that he had me and my sisters.
Sure.
So I never thought of the fact that India had this classical music tradition until I went to India to visit my family when I was a little bit older. And my grandfather was very, very pointed about the fact that I didn't know anything about it. And so he was the one who encouraged me to learn more. And he gave me a sitar and sent me back to the US with a sitar with sort of a mandate to go learn it and learn more about what that tradition was. And that was sort of the opening up around it because, you know, I think coming into it as somebody slightly older, whereas typically when you're studying Indian classical music, you are starting when you're a small kid, like I did with the piano. Mm-hmm. And so I think, like, I never questioned the piano and the historical linearity of Mozart, Beethoven, so on. I think that you don't think about it the same way when you just grow up with it. So having been introduced to it later on, it made me curious. And that's when I started to learn, well, actually, this has existed since the 14th century.
Right.
So, you know, so it's this whole other parallel tradition that is evolving and is deep and rich and it's funny that the name classical music has just come to mean the one thing, isn't it? Because mm-hmm. it's not just in India. Also, there are these really rich traditions in Africa also. Like if you think about the, you know, the griot tradition and
exactly.
and all of that, it's pretty amazing how many of these parallel ways of thinking about music kind of developed.
Yeah, absolutely. I wonder how you weigh your Western classical training against the renewed Indian classical training that you were engaging. It sounds like when it comes to the Western training, there wasn't a ton of family interest. I understand that public school just happened to have a program and that's how you were introduced to it all.
Yeah, so that's part of it. My grandma was a pianist and an organist. And so my mom's side of the family, there are quite a few people who are musicians of different I guess degrees is not the right word, but of different levels of professionalism. No, that's not the right word either. There are people who are professional musicians, and there are people, everybody sort of played something or sang something on my mom's side of the family. But other than taking piano lessons, it wasn't really meant to be something that was a professional career. And I think that's partially because my grandma was a piano teacher and knew how difficult it could be to be a musician. Mm-hmm. But where I grew up, at that time, there was still a public music education program. That school district no longer has the music program anymore. It's been cut. But a lot of my exposure to things outside of what I was hearing at home came directly through that program. So it was very connected to the fact that it is contained in the expectation of the everyday, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Yep. I think often about the fact that if I happen to be a seventh grader in 2020 instead of 19, whatever, maybe I wouldn't be here today. You know, those public school entry points to this art form are so pivotal. Do you think as an industry, we're really thinking about the lasting impact that COVID has had? I feel like in 20 years, maybe it's a stretch to say there will be fewer musicians, but I wouldn't be there. So that has to be the case to some extent.
Oh yeah. No, I think that there's a lost generation that we are not going to see the impact of this for a while. And not just with kids who are not being able to play in elementary school or middle school or high school, but even college level, there are so many students who I think have just sort of given up, which is really heartbreaking because, you know, I feel like we were just starting to get to a place where we were achieving a little more diversity.
Right.
and what, you know, and the impact of the pandemic, as in so many other things, is that it really is this sort of class hierarchy that decides who gets to continue and who doesn't. And, you know, does it seem worth it to pursue music if it's remote and you're still having to work these jobs to do it? And then you know, you're at home and you don't have space to practice and you don't have access to a piano. There are all of these things that come up, and, you know, and that really became apparent. And I think are driving some of the disappearances of people from the industry.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't want to, you know, we definitely have to talk about Rise and all of those things. I don't want to spend too much time here, but you're really unlocking some things in my mind. It's one thing to try to rope a youngster into the fold of Western classical music, but then for many of us, there was just a genuine interest. What do you cite as a turning point for you from, oh, music in school is interesting, to, wow, I actually want to dedicate my life to this?
You know, it's funny to try and think of when that, what the pivotal thing was. And I think it must have been the experience of singing in choir. And maybe even in middle school, I had a choir teacher named Mr. Fernat, who just was this really interesting person. And like, I never met anyone like him before. And I don't know. He just had a way of making us embody the music and really think about the text. And that has stayed with me. And that, you know, that's sort of become my approach to it in general, is how is it embodied and how is the text driving things forward? And I think that if it weren't for him, then I probably wouldn't be where I am now. And then I had a teacher in high school, Mrs. Beck, who she encouraged me to do some arrangements for our show choir. And you know, this was Southern California, so it was a show choir. And we had big hair and sequins and all of that.
Oh, yeah. I'm very familiar.
Yeah. So I arranged a couple of things for the show choir. And that also, I think, was it made me realize that I could do it and that I liked doing it. And so it was that early encouragement from those two people that I think was really, really important.
Yeah, you mentioned the significance of text. When most people, when the uninitiated think of opera, they think of people singing on stage in different languages. Let's say we flip the switch here in the United States and put every opera into the English language. Is the problem solved at that point? Is it text, or is it the actual aesthetic that can seem inaccessible to people from your perspective? What are your ideas on that?
Oh gosh, I think there's so much, you know, because of the way that opera came to America and the way that it has been historically marketed in America, I feel like there's a real perception of it as something that is out of reach, to the fact that most people haven't actually heard someone singing classically in the same room as them before, but everyone will do fake opera voice if you ask them. Yes. And it's so funny because I like to tell this story. I was in a cab in San Francisco. I was there to go to the Opera America conference, and I was taking a taxi from the airport to the conference hotel. And the taxi driver asked me why I was there. And I said, I'm here for an opera conference. And he said, oh, I hate opera. And I said, oh, really? which operas have you seen? And he said, none. Like, how do you know you hate opera? He's like, I just do. I know. And I think that's the problem, is that until you change the way that people think about it at all, you're not going to even get them to listen to a text in Italian or English, or think about how the people are singing, because you have to get them to listen first. Mm-hmm. And I think that we haven't done such a great job of showing why this is still relevant. Why should I listen to this? Why should I care?
And it's one thing to get folks to fall in love with the Magic Flute or Don Giovanni, but new music, as we call it, can be as inaccessible to certain audiences. Do the challenges multiply at that intersection of opera and new music, from your perspective and your experience?
I think it's kind of... They're like a Venn diagram that they intersect in some ways and not in other ways. Mm-hmm. And so people that would come and see something that has like Taking Up Serpents, my last opera at Washington National Opera, has honky tonk in it, like the Bob Wills style honky tonk in it. And I know that that's not everybody's cup of tea, but there are people who hear that and recognize it, and it's a way in, you know. And similarly, like, I think about Daniel Bernard Romain's piece We Shall Not Be Moved, and mm-hmm. how that had so many hip-hop elements in it. And again, it's like some people don't resonate with that, but that audience looked different than most audiences I've been in for opera. So that was really exciting. And I think, you know, we get so caught up in thinking about how can we get everybody to like everything. Mm-hmm. And that's not really the point. The point is, how do you get them invested in this style of art in the first place? I like to think about, you know, prestige television, which there's, you know, you have your HBO, and then you have all of the Disney stuff, mm-hmm. and you have all of your like basic cable stuff. And those shows are all very different, and they have their own audiences, and everybody's fine with that. But then when it comes to something like opera, you know, it has to be, everybody has to, what one audience likes has to be the same as what another audience likes. And I don't think that's true. And I know that a lot of it comes down to funding, and how everyone is struggling with budgeting, and how do you pay for things that are so expensive if they're not going to recoup what you paid out. But I think that there are multiple levels of creating these pieces that are possible. And we're starting to see that, right? Like chamber operas, mm-hmm. in addition to the giant opera with the orchestra and the full chorus. And now even digital pieces that are being made that are specifically meant to be online.
That's what I think is one of the silver linings we can pull out of this time, is that I can enjoy opera in my pajamas. I don't have to go get dressed up or go anywhere. So, you know, there are things to celebrate with those evolutions. So you have an opera coming up, the premiere of an opera with the Washington National Theater. And the general theme across all of these world premieres is the idea of monuments. So just generally speaking, I wonder what your response is to a critique of physical monuments. There are a lot of people who believe that statues are something of the past. Nothing should be written in stone in that way. What are your ideas on that?
I think it's really kind of brave to the Kennedy Center to do this for their anniversary of the fact that they are a monument. It's just mm-hmm. a question. But I think we need to question, you know, because the thing about monuments is that they are emblematic of the way that we as a culture see ourselves and the story we are telling about ourselves. And often what that means is the story gets co-opted by the people who happen to be in power. And the outcome of that is that the people who are in power stay in power because that's the story. Is that right. This is these are the people who know, these are the people who lead, these are our heroes, this is what you must look like, this is what you must do. And that points us in a particular direction. So I do think it's important to question what our monuments and our stories are. But that being said, I do think it's also important to have those stories. And what is exciting about where we are now is that history and this idea of the straightforward line is being questioned. And we're seeing, you know, the emphasis being placed more on people who were also there and also important, but were not part of the storytelling at the time. And mm-hmm. so we're left out. And I think that that's part of what all of these pieces are doing in their own way, is questioning, you know, what does it mean to tell the story of our culture through art and through these statues? And what does it mean to say this is something that is solid and cannot be altered, when there is more fluidity and complexity and ambiguity always at all points in that line? It's not a straight line.
Yeah. These things, these solid things that cannot and should never be changed, of course, reminds us all of Western classical music, at least in the way that we've been treating it. How does your new opera, how does Rise specifically engage that conversation?
I think that A.M. Holmes, the librettist, has done something very smart, because the monument that we are dealing with is the portrait monument, which is a monument to suffragettes. It was unveiled in 1921, and it has three women on it, who are Lucretia Mott, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and of course, Susan B. Anthony. And it's a very strange looking sculpture. It's like half of each of these women coming out of a giant block of marble. And then there's sort of an unfinished blob of marble in the back of the statue. Mm-hmm. And the story of it is that it was unveiled and then immediately sent down into what's called the crypt, which is sort of the basement of the Capitol building. And it just sort of sat there in a corner for 75 years before a group of women senators raised enough money to bring it back up to the rotunda, which is where it is now. So, you know, there's one version of an opera which just tells the story of that monument and, you know, the ladies who brought it back and yay, everything's hunky-dory. But that is not what A.M. did. And mm-hmm. I think that that's why this piece has more resonance, is because she looked at that and she said, well, you know, what about the Black suffragettes? None of them are there. We don't see any representation of what women and women's rights are now, or who is fighting, or any of that. And so she has the monument as sort of a jumping off point for this, mm-hmm. for a larger discussion about what it means to have a monument, but also about what is your connection if you don't see yourself represented in the story that the country is telling. What do you do about that?
Yeah.
So the libretto focuses around a Latina Girl Scout and her trip to the Capitol building. She gets separated from her Girl Scout troop and meets a Black Capitol police officer and the ghost of Adelaide Johnson, who was the sculptor of the monument itself. And they kind of have a conversation. And that's the piece. I think it's a way of dealing with the monument without making it specifically about the monument. And mm-hmm. that, I think, is the better way to engage with it.
A lot of people through this piece of music will learn about the existence of this monument. I didn't know that it was a thing before I took on this project. But something that I've really been wrestling with in my mind, just thinking a lot about, is the way that the legacy of women's rights has mm-hmm. centered Susan B. Anthony in mm-hmm. a really interesting way. I even remember the silver dollar that we used to get in school for making straight A's or whatever. Over time, as you've mentioned, we've recontextualized the way we think about women's rights from a historical perspective to ask the question, where are the women of color? I wonder how you've seen the conversation of women's rights from that historical narrative evolve over the years, if at all, away from Susan B. Anthony, offering more depth to her. What's been your experience with that?
I think that the problem that we always face in dealing with the story that we're telling is that we want to have a hero, right? And we want to have the one person that leads the way through everything. So we end up with somebody like Susan B. Anthony, and we forget everybody else. And so I think what's been interesting is while there has been a lot of talking about including Sojourner Truth. And you see this in New York, actually, that there was a sculpture that went up in Central Park that originally was supposed to, it was just Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, I think. And then there was a whole petition to include Sojourner Truth also. And she finally got added to the statue before it was put up in the park. So I think there's a push there, but I also think it's interesting that I've seen more writing about other women of color involved in the movement in the United States. And so I'm hopeful that there's something about the fact that we're already questioning the linearity of the narrative and mm-hmm. the need for a hero in the narrative that's allowing more of these women's stories to be included. So I'm hopeful about the conversations, because at least we're open to nuance and saying, well, you know, Susan B. Anthony had a lot of problems, sure. right? And we have to talk about that also. It's just sort of again, going back to classical music, is this genius problem that we have, mm-hmm. right? That we have a tendency to want to say that there are these great men throughout history, and they're the ones who are the innovators, and they stand alone, and they don't have any help, when the truth is more complex than that and more nuanced. There's always other people in the background working, and the question is just, do we recognize them or not? You know, yeah. how full, how rich, how varied do we want our storytelling to be?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. One thing that we haven't mentioned is that in this portrait monument, you know, we have those three busts, and then there's a sort of blank spot. There's a spot where obviously something could be included there, but has yet to be. And also, you mentioned the name Sojourner Truth. There was a big push to include her in that monument, and unfortunately, that failed. I wonder how you balance that unfortunate bit of history with the idea, again, of challenging writing things in stone. Is it better that it's left blank, or should we include Sojourner Truth or the face of another woman of color in this monument?
I think that there's always space to to rewrite. I mean, I know part of the issue, it was around, I think, the fact that there were people who didn't think there was enough material left in the marble to create the bust. So that's the other part of it, right? Is you want to honor and respect, but you don't want to do it in a way that leaves the person second, sort of like a second fiddle. Like, I wouldn't want to see Sojourner Truth added to the statue, but like one third the size.
Exactly. else. Yeah, that would be unfortunate. Wow. What do you hope that audiences sort of take away on the broadest scope when they see Rise? Again, we started talking about accessibility to opera and affirming its relevance in today's society. Is there a message concerning opera as a genre that you hope folks take away from this?
Yes. I mean, I think one of the things that's really powerful about seeing opera in person is you hear the voices and how they work in a room. So when you're in a large theater and there's like a big orchestra, the fact that these women are singing and you can hear them, right? And that they hit these notes that are powerful and that are sometimes very high. It's almost a superhuman feat. And this piece, Rise, doesn't have any male singers in it. So it's all cast of all women. And it passes the Bechdel test. And so I hope that people see it and come away, one, with just the sense of these singers' musicality and real talent, but that also embedded in it is a lot of sort of fodder for thought and for conversation, right? Mm-hmm. This question, who is written in stone, and what do you do if you don't see yourself in the story, right? Mm-hmm. That it's about nuance and about, like, there is no hard and fast answer to the question of who should be written in stone, right? Or who do we celebrate? It's sort of like it tells us who we are as a people. And I think that's the guiding thing, is who do we want to be as a people, and how do we want to point ourselves towards the future? And a lot of that is bound up in the stories that we tell also.
Technically speaking, when it comes to writing the music for this, was it a challenge, or was it easier to center on women's voices? What was that like, not using the bass clef staff at all? I mean, was that a thing?
Yeah, it's interesting because the women's writing, because they're so treble heavy, you know, I have a lot of low brass that I use.
Oh, wow, okay.
To sort of counterbalance it. And it was fun because I got to write a 5-part chorale for them. And you don't always get to do that in opera. And I also had a lot of fun thinking about sort of how to musicalize this journey of our young Girl Scout from when she enters the piece. She's sort of out of her element, and it's very chaotic. It's the capital. And then by the end, she sort of found her way in. And so I decided to start with music that's inspired by serialism and also military band. So it's sort of this atonal march, but then by the end, the cell of the row, the melody that comes out of the row, is transformed into something that is in a more open scale. So there's a lot of like musical nerdery happening also.
Sure. Well, you know, folks like us have to be engaged as audience members as well. So, you know, a little meat, for proverbial meat for us to chew on. With all of these things in mind, do you still see a role for the so-called traditional opera? Do you still see a role for Rossini and all of these folks in the ecosystem, considering the conversations that you're able to engage with new opera?
I think so. You know, because there is something about universal story that can be found in these older operas. You know, people still fall in love. They still argue with each other. They still have heartbreak. I think that where the difficulty comes is that we often forget about the humanness of these older pieces, and we focus on doing them correctly, quote unquote, so that they become sort of calcified and they're not allowed to live and breathe and resonate with the modern audiences. And I know that, you know, a lot of contemporary stagings try to solve this by updating where they take place, like putting them in Las Vegas or whatever, but that's not necessarily getting at what the heart of the piece is. Like, if you can make the audience feel like, oh, this is a woman who is in love and has been betrayed, and that's why she's getting stabby, I think, you know, that's a better way in than, you know, they're in Las Vegas. So I think there's room for that. I think, but I also think that we can't cover over the fact that these are coming from different places in time. And what was acceptable at that point in time, the norms are not acceptable now, you know, and we can't just say, well, you know, the audience will figure it out. No, I think we have to put it in context and have conversation and be really clear, you know, what is it that's still of value about this piece? Why do we want to do this piece? And if we can say, you know, this is what I love about this piece, this is why I want to do it, even while acknowledging that there are these other problematic elements, then I think it will be easier to invite people in than if I just say, this is a great piece, you should like it. You, if you don't like it, you don't know anything. And that's sort of how we've been about it. Because if you don't like Mozart, then there must be something wrong with you. I don't think that's helping anybody.
So to that point, what's your advice to the folks who are going to get in the back of a cab or an Uber or whatever and have to deal with a driver like you have who doesn't like opera? What's your advice to those people to actually get somewhere in the conversation?
Well, I asked him, I said, what kind of music do you like? And he said, hip hop. And I said, well, you know, there's this piece called We Shall Not Be Moved that has hip hop in it. You should listen to that. And I don't know if he ever did, but I know that if he did, he would find something in there to resonate with. And I think that's the other wonderful thing about the pieces that are being written now, is because they draw on popular music, which, let's be honest, you know, Mozart did that too.
Right.
We just, you know, that music is not popular now. So we forget like how kind of shocking it is for him to put like dance hall kinds of things in his pieces.
Turkish military band music, all of that.
Exactly. So that's just what composers have always done. It's just that now the popular music is very different, right? Very different than what you're used to if you're just thinking about music that comes from 100, 200 years ago. And so I think that new music can, and a new opera can serve as a gateway to old opera in some ways. You know, like, not everyone is going to go back and want to come and see Bohème. Not everyone will, but there might be one who does, who wouldn't have, and that's already one more person. And I think that one person having an emotional and beautiful experience is worth it, is worth doing it.
Yeah. I have one more question for you, but before we get there, how can folks learn more about you, and how can they check out Rise coming up?
You can go to my website, which is www.kamalashankaram.com. You can also go look at my band's website, which is Bombay Rickey, Rickey with an E, like a cocktail. And Rise opens on March 5th at the Kennedy Center. And I hope that we will see you there. I would love to continue having this conversation.
Yeah, absolutely. All right. Hard-hitting question for the very end. You mentioned that this opera surrounds the story of a young Girl Scout. What's your favorite Girl Scout cookie?
Oh my gosh. You know, I always said tagalongs, the peanut butter one.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. I like thin mints, but only if they're frozen.
Oh, frozen thin mints. Instead of written in stone, maybe frozen as hard as stone or to draw that connection. Kamala, thank you so much for speaking with me today. We're looking forward to Rise. Thank you.
Thank you. It's been great.
Another Bombay Rickey track there called Taki, Rari. And let me make a quick correction while we're here. The name of the track that got us into it, the project is called Electric Bhairavi. The tune is called Megalodon. So two really cool tunes there by Bombay Rickey to sandwich the conversation that I had with Kamala Sankaram. Before we get into the fourth movement, you know, one thing I want to ask you, sort of the question that I teased before we got into the interview, the idea of what should be written in stone. I'm from the South, where there has always been a conversation about Confederate monuments from the time I was a child. You know, that conversation has just been a part of it. I wonder what your initial reactions are to the idea of things written in stone, or the question, should things be written in stone, literally or proverbially, considering how we evolve as people and, you know.
Yeah, so are we talking like commandment level things?
Anything, any nuance of the conversation.
See, the more I think about it, the more I want to say, I think that we should have very few things written in stone, and those should be the ones that are the easiest. You know, you don't kill anybody. You know, the basics, how to be a good person, right? Because things have changed, things evolve, things, you know, or at least you hope things will get better,
sure,
right, through change.
I'm thinking
so,
about.
So yeah, I'm reluctant to have something written in stone just because, you know, there's a lot of things in the Constitution that we need to get rid of.
And a lot of people, all the people who wrote it, first of all, we need to get them out of here.
But what I'm saying is that wouldn't you consider the Constitution essentially stone?
No, because that's what all of the amendments are, right? So that the Constitution isn't even something that has been written in stone. It's something that has evolved over the years. There's even
But everybody points to it as the founding fathers.
Yeah, but I'm saying not even that is written in stone. There's even been trivia question. There's even been an amendment taken away. Do you know what that is, or can you think of that?
Was it the drinking one?
Right. That was once written in stone, quote unquote,
Amendment.
But it wasn't really, because it was taken away. So even what our democracy is built on is not something that's written in stone. It's something that's written on paper, and something that can be added to, and something that has already been taken away from. So maybe, I don't even think that can be cited as an example.
What about certain amendments? Because the Second Amendment certainly is not going anywhere, right? That's stone.
You never
Has
know.
Has anybody taken that
you
out?
You never know. I mean, but my point is, I don't think we can say that about any of them, considering the non-written in stone nature of the Constitution. I don't think that we can give any of the, you know, Roe v. Wade, mm-hmm. you know, speaking of, you know, women's rights during Women's History Month, you know, that is something that, in many people's opinion, from their perspectives, when it first took hold, was written in stone. And we're saying that's being challenged, right? So I don't think there's anything that we can say is going to stick around for good, not even that beloved Second Amendment that people, you know, always go to.
I see what you're saying. To get back to you, to answer it, I'm reluctant to put things in stone.
Yeah. Well, I will be leading a pre-opera conversation that's going to explore some of these things, the way that women's history has been contextualized and recontextualized. So I'm really looking forward to that. Huge shout out to everyone over at the Kennedy Center for having me, to all of the composers. Another special thank you to Kamala for joining me here on Trilloquy. We're going to get into this fourth movement. The piece I want to use to transition us, Scott, so I already mentioned that I went and did bassoon masterclasses down at the Schwab School of Music. Mm-hmm. I'm going to give a shout out to Eric Lopez, who's down there pursuing an artist diploma. He brought a piece to the masterclass that inspired me to take a look at it. And I'm going to start practicing it and see if I can't perform it sometime soon. I always considered the ultimate compliment being, oh, wow, I played this so well that someone else wants to play it. Mm. So that is something that Eric Lopez did for me. So shout out to Eric Lopez for bringing in the Concertino by Brazilian composer Francisco Mignone. We are going to hear Eric Lopez's take on it this time, of course, because it's not recorded, but the one and only Frank Morelli has recorded it. So we're going to listen to the end of that second movement here to get us into our fourth movement. You know, Frank Morelli is really good about using that tongue very, how can I say, athletically, you know, just showing the world that, yes, he can double and triple tongue and articulate all the notes. So, you know, shout out to Frank Morelli. Shout out to Francisco Mignone for writing a such an incredible piece for the bassoon. Shout out to Eric Lopez for inspiring me to take a look at it myself. And shout out to all of you for sticking around for this final movement. This is going to be a short final movement this week. But what I do want to mention, so in addition to hosting masterclasses down there, I was able to address the Black Schwab Society, where the Black students were able to come and, you know, air their grievances with me. We explored lots of different conversations. There were a few allies and potential accomplices there, and mm-hmm. it was a really rich experience. I'm really grateful for the experience to get to do that. I started the meeting by laying out a few points that I do not sacrifice on and that I believe that the students should not sacrifice on. So the very first of them, and I mean, it's right here at the top of my list. I have my notes pulled up. The very first of them is, don't let anyone gaslight your Black experience. Remember when we started the downbeat with the Paul Robeson excerpt when he was in court mm-hmm. and the person overseeing the hearing was like, I don't know what this racism is you're talking about because you graduated from Rutgers and X, Y, and Z and da, da, da. That's one of the prime tools used to try to get folks to think differently about their own Black experience, you know, gaslighting that Black experience, saying that it's not true, it's not happening. So the first thing that I told those students is be aware of that tactic and don't let it take hold on you, even when it appears in the news, as it did this week. I want to play a little excerpt here where an EU official calls Ukraine refugee discrimination fake news. Let's take a listen, Scott.
Members of the European Parliament for Poland assured us that these are fake news. This is not true. And honestly, we have not been able to corroborate that.
I have corroborated it. I have talked to Africans and Indians who have both said they said that they were being pushed off trains, that they were being left behind. These are women and children.
Any discrimination among people who are fleeing the conflict, the basis of any personal characteristic, including citizenship or skin color, is completely unacceptable.
So that was Sarah Sidner asking the question there, mm-hmm. CNN's Sarah Sidner. People are beginning, and maybe I shouldn't say beginning too, but something that I have started to hear in regards to what's going on over in Europe right now is this as an information war. So there are certain things, certain firsthand accounts we have gotten, certain things that we're hearing from EU officials, like the man that we just heard from there, and dissonance, some things not connecting. What's your reaction to hearing that, considering what we've talked about between us and also here on this podcast concerning the nuance of what's happening over there in Europe, the fact that we have to remember that there are Black folks and people of color in the midst of mm-hmm. the Ukrainian refugees being discriminated against. So we have that. We have this EU official saying something different. What's your reaction? What's your response?
What else would he have said?
Go on. No, say more. Say
no,
more.
No, what is he? Is he going to jump on there and go, yeah, yeah, that happened. Yeah, we don't know why that happened. What is? No, he's going to try to make an excuse for it.
Okay.
He's the spokesperson.
So?
He's the excuse man.
That's a good one, excuse man. So let's connect that to the arts. Mm. Okay.
Okay. How?
If orchestras, opera houses, radio stations, conservatories, schools of music, you name it, if they are alleging that racism doesn't have a place here through the statements that you put on the websites, through the things you say live, even by programming music by Black composers, if they are saying this sort of thing does not exist, this sort of racism discrimination doesn't exist where we are and is unacceptable, based on the material that we all have from our lived experiences, why are we supposed to just take that and say, oh, okay, well, they must be one of the good institutions. So it's fine. They're safe. Mm. I think this is one example of what so many people, so many women, so many people of color experience on a day-to-day basis, being gaslit into believing that something you know to be true is not true. I hope this EU official has been called into someone's office. I'm not saying I want anybody to lose their job necessarily, but I hope that he has been enlightened on reality. I hope that someone has come to him and said, actually, this is what's happening. This is the true tea, only so that we can all learn and that we can all take a moment to acknowledge the fact that anti-Blackness is global and that even in the midst of war, there are people experiencing this. We have to be empowered to really speak our truth and to make sure that we aren't being gaslit into believing something different. Continue to stand firm. Don't be talked out of your training. Don't be talked out of your lived experience. Don't be talked out of your truth. Thank you, everyone, for listening. We'll see you next time.